There was a time in the life of the Israelites, they were sent away from their homes. They were captured and they became captives. They had no inheritance. They had no property. The situation was very bad to the extent that they lost everything, including the house of God. When they were taken away into exile, captivity, they were wondering, what have we done to deserve this? What is our mistake? God wanted to give them some answers, so he sent them a prophet called Isaiah. This prophet Isaiah came and told them, you Israelites, you Catholics, you Christians, you are getting this because you have disobeyed the Lord. You listening to me, what you are going through is because you have disobeyed the Lord. So think twice, repent, and then God will bless you. In fact, if you read the whole book of Isaiah, it has 66 chapters. From chapter 1 to chapter 39, Isaiah speaks against the people. Repent, otherwise God will punish you. His language in chapter 1 to chapter 39 was very severe. Because God was speaking to people, you have to change. There was no friendly tone, full of harsh words. I don't know whether already 2017, we are in October. If this half of the year, you might call it, this chapter of the year, I don't know how you have felt or you are feeling. As you sit here listening to me in God's house, if you look back the last 10 months, what will you say? Has God forgotten about you? Are you going through challenges? Are you going through difficulties? Can you talk like the Israelites and say, God, I don't know why you are doing this to me? God's message for you this morning is that he has a way. Amen.
Amen.
Now, today's reading came from chapter 45. Friends, if you care to know, the difference is that if you read from chapter 40 to chapter 66, the last chapter, the man Isaiah, who was insulting, so to say, the people, who was condemning the people, so to say, now turns to talk about hope. Now, don't worry, God knows your situation. Don't worry, God understands what you are going through, and God will make a way for you. He'll bring a deliverance for you. Amen. That is why we hear in this chapter 45, which is the second half of Isaiah's prophecy, his book, the message of hope. So even if 10 months of 2017 have been difficult for you, God is saying the 2 months left are enough to change your story. He said that the remaining weeks of the year are enough for him to turn your story and give you hope. If your hope is finished, used up, he's saying that he's going to renew your hope and give you a future. Amen.
Amen.
So when Isaiah started speaking these words, the people were happy. Because they realized that, oh, after all, God has not forgotten about me. He has not forgotten about my marriage. He has not forgotten about my desire to get a married partner. He has not forgotten about my children who are going through difficulties. The schools, the challenges, those who are studying, you know. God has not forgotten about them, so they were happy. But God gave them a blessing. God gave them an answer that they never expected. One, he told them that there is a king called King Cyrus. His name was mentioned. This King Cyrus wasn't a Jew. He wasn't an Israelite. The people had gone to his country because they are slaves. Don't forget, the Israelites were slaves at that time. You know, sometimes sin makes us slaves. You know, you see, we go back to the same sin. The last 1 month, the sin, this same particular sin, you have been committing it every day because we have become slaves of that sin. And because they were slaves in this country of the king, in this empire, the king of the king, Cyrus, God had to use the same man to give them their deliverance. So he begins by calling even this king, who is not a Christian, who is not a Catholic. Imagine God using someone who is not a Christian to bless you, to change your story. That's what was happening. So God said, Cyrus, you are my anointed. Cyrus stands for anybody who thinks he is not part of God's special ones. today he was speaking to Cyrus in the reading. And he's speaking to us today that even if you are a Cyrus in life, you think you are not a special one of God, you are not special to God, he can use you to bring blessing. Amen.
Amen.
So God calls this king Cyrus an anointed man. Usually those who are anointed are people who are Jews, who are Israelites, who are God's friends. And yet God is calling him anointed man. That is not all. And then he goes on to say, you Cyrus, you listening to me, you think that you are nobody. I will make sure that I will open every door ahead of you. I'm reading from, taking from the first reading. So that nothing will stop you. So that wherever you have to go, I will make sure that all the doors are open for you to pass through. I don't know which closed doors you are waiting behind. I don't know which doors have been closed on you this year, this month. But like God speaking to Cyrus, he's speaking to today. Whatever closed door that is before you, open it for you.
Amen.
If he wants you to pass through those closed doors, may we all walk through every closed door of our lives.
Amen.
May every closed door in my life that's bringing a difficulty and challenge, may they begin to open one by one.
Amen.
God speaks to his servant, Cyrus. I'm going to open every door before you. I'm going to bless you. We know that this man, King Cyrus, had the largest empire, kingdom. It was so huge. Because God blessed him because he was going to use him to bless his people. If God needs to use someone to bless you, he will use him to bless you. Amen.
Amen.
If God needs to use someone to bless you, he will use her to bless you. Amen.
Amen.
So it's because of the Israelites, my friend, don't forget that. This king is blessed because of the Israelites. God wanted to change their story to set them free, so he had to bless this king to set the people free. You see what God can do for you? What God can do for me? We are told that for God so loved the world that he came down to die for us. See, because God needed to come to save you, you sitting here, you listen to me, you alone, he had to send down his son. What can't he send your way? May he send every person to come your way this month, this year. May he send every breakthrough in your life.
Amen.
So God speaks to this king, I'll open doors before you, and gates may never be closed on you. May no gate be closed on you.
Amen.
That ends the story. The Israelites finally went back home. They were free, and they had time to worship their God. May whatever is making us difficult to worship God in love, in peace, in joy, may all those things be taken away. Maybe we can begin to have the peace of Christ, that we shall worship God in happiness and truth. Amen.
Amen.
Paul, who wrote the second reading, the first book of the letter to the Thessalonians, many years ago, it was around the year AD 51, which means around maybe 20 years after Jesus had ascended to heaven. So Paul comes to the scene, not meeting Jesus physically, but as you know the story of this man, Paul, he was converted. He was changed, we say, from Saul to what? Paul. No, what happened was that because he had this life-changing encounter, he decided to go around to what? To make new disciples, Christians. So Paul was traveling from place to place. We know he traveled 3 times. Now, on his second journey, which is called the second missionary journey, what happened was that Paul went to a place called Thessalonica. He went there to preach about Jesus. And that day, when he got there, the people were there in the synagogue, we are told like this. He preached so well that the people were touched. He said, let me repeat my message again. So the following week, Paul went back and preached again, and the people were touched. He said, let me go for a third time. For the third week, he went back and preached again, and the people were touched. And then because by the third week, most of the people in Thessalonica were becoming Christians. They were rushing to listen to Paul. The numbers were growing. So some people were not happy that he was succeeding. So they planned to kill him. So because they planned to kill Paul, some of the Christians whom he had changed, brought into the church, they heard of it and then told Paul, Paul, please leave this city before you are killed. If you read Acts chapter 17, the story is there. And so in Acts chapter 17, we hear that Paul had to run away from that city. He spent only how many weeks? 3 weeks. 3 weeks. So after 3 weeks of evangelizing, preaching, teaching about Jesus, he had to run away. So when he ran away, finally he got to a place where he was okay. But he was thinking about these men and women in Thessalonica. For 3 weeks, I preached to them. My message, has the message touched them? Can they keep that message for the rest of their lives? Only 3 weeks. So he was wondering. So he said, let me do something. He sent somebody called Timothy to go to them, to go and ask what is happening. Timothy came back with the good news. Paul, your people in Thessalonica are doing very well. They have kept the faith. Amen.
Amen.
May we become like the people of Thessalonica, the Thessalonians we are called. May our faith be kept alive despite every challenge. Amen.
Amen.
St. Anthony. St. Anthony.
Pray for us.
May the people of St. Anthony's church, may their faith be kept alive. Amen.
Amen.
So 3 weeks was enough to keep their faith alive. But then Timothy told Paul, but they have a little bit of confusions about when Jesus will come and why their people are dying, Jesus is not coming. So Paul said, okay, to help them, I'll write a letter. So that is the history behind this letter we are writing. Paul had waited only for 3 weeks, so he wrote to them to encourage them. He never went back there anyway, but his words, messages got to them, and the people's lives became so strong in the faith. So he listened to him talking. That's why we hear him encouraging the people, saying that, I pray for you every day, every day. If you're a Christian, if you're a Catholic, you are blessed, because every day you are prayed for. Today we shall pray for people who are not here in the church, because our prayers are not for only Catholics, they are for every Christian, those who are not being here physically. Take courage in the fact that you are being prayed for. Amen.
Amen.
Take courage in the fact that you are not alone as a Christian. Other Christians are solidly behind you. And may the faith that you have now continue to grow to the glory of God. Amen.
Amen.
I'll end with the gospel, where Jesus talks about the Pharisees and the Herodians and their tax question. Obviously, the whole thing he was saying, that if we are Christian, doesn't mean that you are not in the world. Are you aware you are in the world?
Yes.
St. Anthony.
Yes.
Arise, Caliph faithful.
Yes.
Are you aware you are in the world?
Yes.
That's all that Jesus is saying. Once you are Christian, you are in this world, conform to what is here. But don't forget, you are a Christian with two citizenships. They call it dual citizenship. Because some people have dual citizenship. They belong to our country and some other country. So you belong here, but you belong to another home in heaven. So you are a citizen of heaven. Amen.
Amen.
Tell the person sitting next to you,
you are a citizen of heaven.
Repeat it to her. Then sometimes we forget about that. We think that we are only citizens of this earth, in this world. So when we challenges come, troubles come, then we begin to conclude, no, this is not your final place. You are still of the place up there in heaven. So Jesus tells them, if you're a Christian, you are supposed to come to church, you are supposed to pay tax, you are supposed to obey traffic rules, you are supposed to obey those ones. But don't forget that at the heart of everything, that there's something, a citizenship up there that awaits you. That is the everlasting citizenship. We pray that you become law-abiding citizens of our dear country. Above all, become law-abiding citizens of the world to come. May our desire to see Jesus face to face someday gain at this season forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.